Fantastic. All right, we're back, family, with our dearest doctor and elder, Dr. Edwin Nichols, founding member of the Association of Black Psychologists and author of Cultural Competence in America's Schools, Leadership, Engagement, and Understanding. He is a clinical industrial psychologist working in organization development. He's the director of the Nichols Association, Inc., an applied behavioral science firm where the goal is to restructure organizations to achieve systemic congruence and process through cultural competence and leadership. And his hallmark paradigm is known as the philosophical aspects of cultural difference, which affords insights into the essence of ethnic difference from the philosophical disciplines of axiology, epistemology, and logic. Welcome back, Dr. Nichols.
Thank you very much. Good to see you guys again.
Good to see you again. You're looking well, and I'm jealous again because I want to borrow your daughter, because every time I talk to you, your daughter is buying you something extravagant or taking you somewhere extravagant, and I'm just jealous about that, and so I just want to share that with you personally. Give her my love. Give her my love.
Thank you.
Now, we're supposed to be talking about dichotomous logic and colorism, but in our conversations leading up to this conversation today, you shared with me that you do a lot of work with police stations and police officers and law enforcement, and you know, particularly what's going on right now, what just happened here in my town and with Stephon Clark. And so let's go back and have a relook at the philosophical aspects of cultural difference. And then I guess we can go into dichotomous logic and we can kind of flow from there. How about that?
Okay. All right. I like to start back with the paradigm. And the reason is that if we review the paradigm, it will put into place logically how systems work. Mm-hmm. In this country, as African Americans and as other minorities, but specifically African Americans, we are subjected to systemic institutional white racism. So systemic means that in all of the systems, every single system that we have, law, rental properties, residential, police, in every system, it is institutionalized, which means within that system, it is an integral part. Mm-hmm. Then the sum product is white racism.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So that if you start with that as a reality, then the only way you can explain it is through philosophical understanding of the European value system, the African value system, the Asian and the Native American, but we're not going through all of those. We're just going to use the African American and the European.
Okay.
Now, in the European value system, the highest value for them is always the object or the acquisition of the object. Mm-hmm. And that comes from what was necessary for them to survive and thrive as an ethnic entity starting in Europe. They are the last group of people to come into being a whole ethnic group. They're only an ethnic group no more than 20,000, generally between 15 and 20,000 years ago. Mm-hmm. And the reason being that you can only get up into Europe, Switzerland, Germany, at the end of the last ice age, which was 15,000 years ago. So prior to that time, they don't exist.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now we know that there are other groups of subhumans there, you know, and of course, we know also that in the genetic makeup, you see some of these. Some of this blood or some of these genes from that group of people.
Mm-hmm. You're talking about the sapien, not the sapien, but the sapien?
No, we're talking about in Europe, the The Neanderthal.
The Neanderthal. Okay. Yes.
Yes. There, with many, with some people that are from the northern part of Germany and Sweden and so forth, when you look at them genetically, they have Neanderthal products, 4%, 3%, 2%, something like that. So the point that I'm making is that their culture is a recent and new culture.
Mm.
But it was an extremely harsh culture that forced them to develop ways of living in order to survive and be here next spring.
Mm-hmm.
And so the object itself, food, shelter, safety, those were the most important things because they weren't omnipresent.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't have it stored, if you don't harvest it, if you don't plant at the right time in which to harvest and to store, and you learn how to preserve and to be very careful in your measurement of time, even in the measurement of how much food you could eat per month, because you could run out if you ate too much in 1 month. So you have a society which is very much into counting and measuring, which is their epistemology.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because if you missed and didn't complete the task at the end of that time frame, you were dead.
Mm-hmm.
So if you woke up this morning, you didn't feel like plowing, and this is the week to plow, you're going to plow 10 days later. 10 days later, you go, at the end of the season, you need those 10 days
because
mm-hmm. things won't be right. And the storm comes and you die. You don't have any food. So you can't criticize them for the way in which they see the world and how they act in the world, because it was their survival.
So is that the process of axiology in terms of how they value?
Yes, that's their axiological referent, that the highest value lies in that object or its acquisition. Now, with that, an issue that's difficult for us to understand is that if you go to the origins of people in Africa, food is omnipresent.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the biggest thing that they had to do was to do it in a timely way and have it and store it and save it and fight over it to protect it.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go to someplace else in the world, it's omnipresent. Every time you look out, there's something to eat.
Mm-hmm.
It's not an issue. So the most important thing for groups of people in that situation were to maintain and establish relationships.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
You have to be able to communicate with each other, to be friendly with each other, to know each other, to appreciate each other. Essential. Now, in terms of us as African Americans, sharing is an integral part of that African heritage.
Mm-hmm.
You share. Because there's plenty. There's no reason not to share. But now let's go back to the North, to this European situation. You say to me, Nichols, you have 12 baskets of wheat. Well, I have 12 baskets of wheat, but I've got to have enough wheat for 9 months. You just say to me, well, Nichols, if you got 12 baskets, why don't you share and give me half? Give me 6 baskets.
Mm-hmm.
Share. That is total nonsense.
Mm-hmm.
If I give you 6, that means that you're dead in 6 months and I'm dead in 6 months, and it takes us 9 months to manage the winter, plus an extra month in case something goes wrong.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not sharing anything with you. Now, if you put that onto the world stage, then you see what we call exploitation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Hoarding the resources.
Yes, and not share. Go in and take out the resources we need, right, and leave it, you know, with some token response.
Mm-hmm.
Years ago, it was beads and trinkets, you know. Now it's a house in Switzerland.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Makes perfect sense.
Okay. Now, with that understanding, then we have to go to what is the logic system that they use that keeps them alive?
Uh-huh.
And that logic system is dichotomous. So if the highest value is in the object, either the thing that I have in my hand is the object or it is not the object. Mm-hmm. So with that logic system of either or, we call it binary. Now, in and of itself, as binary logic, there's nothing wrong with it. You can have plus or minus. You can have yes or no, or A or B, or zero or one. And that's the structure of computer science in Western civilization. Okay? But the damage comes when you move that from a binary system into a logic system that affects people, persons, and products or outcomes. Mm-hmm.
You said that logic is how you reason to an answer is logic. Yes. Is that correct?
That's logic. How do you reason to an answer? That's logic. Now, let's look at the two logic systems and look and see what's important. If the highest value lies in the object, logic has to tell me whether this is the object or it is not the object. Mm-hmm. That's what's important for me to be able to reason to the answer that yes, this is the object or no, this is not the object. Now, if the highest value lies in the relationship, as Africans, we can't use that logic system. The reason is it won't keep the value system in place. Mm-hmm. Because in that logic system, if I am right, you have to be what?
Wrong.
And if you are right, I am what?
Wrong.
How long then can we keep a relationship as the highest value?
We cannot.
Okay, so then we must have our own logic system.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. Vernon Dixon coined the word diunital. It is a union of opposites. He never gets the notice that he should have as a great scholar. He was an economist, but he's a great scholar. And diunital is a union of opposites. Now, in that same square, when you look at ethnic groups on that paper, it says Latino. It also, Latino, Latina, it also says Arab, doesn't it?
We're looking at philosophical aspects of culture.
I'm going to the far left column.
Yep.
And you see under ethnic groups, you see Latino and Arab. Now, yeah. They are not in and of themselves an ethnic group, but they share an ethnic worldview.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And to share an ethnic worldview is three things. A colonial a catastrophic event that changed everything for your group of people forever. Forced to speak another language exclusively and forced to convert to a new religion. If your ancestors were Inca, Maya, Aztec, or Caribbean Indians, they were subjected to colonial Spain, forced to speak Spanish exclusively, and forced to convert to Catholicism. Mm-hmm. If you are Arab, you are subjected to the Islamic wars that go all the way through to Spain, 1490, all the way into 711. Mm-hmm. Okay. You convert to Islam, and you speak Arabic exclusively. That's why when you go to the Middle East, you have people who do two, but not the third. They don't call themselves Arabs, they call themselves Kurds, mm-hmm. Assyrians, Druze. They are not the same because they don't have all three factors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay?
Understood.
Now, do those groups that I have in that same pod with African Americans, Latinos, and Arabs, do they have also the same type of logic system as diunital? Yes, they do. You go all the way back to the Aztecs, and they have this logic system, and they call it difracismo.
Mm-hmm.
If you go to Ibn Arabi, a brilliant philosopher in the Arab culture, and he gives you the in between, but you have to look at my hands here.
Okay.
This is your opinion. This is my opinion. And the logic says it must be the in between.
Mm-hmm. IBN.
You see?
Mm-hmm.
The in between. Between the two of us. It's coming to that point at which there's a unity between two things that are ostensibly in opposition. Mm-hmm. Right back to the thinking. All right.
Is this what you also call quantum theory?
No, no. Yeah, well, that's the only way you can do quantum theory.
Mm-hmm.
You see, you have math. There's logic that you have in math, and they'll argue with you that it's not diunital, but it is. See, you get Newtonian theory. You get from dichotomous logic, plus minus yes, no, A, B. But if you have particle theory and wave theory, okay,
mm-hmm.
you use dichotomous logic. If it's waves, it cannot be what? Particles.
Mm-hmm.
If it's particles, it cannot be what?
Waves.
But if you use diunital, diphrasismo, or the in-between, then you can visualize particles moving in waves.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then you can go to quantum theory.
So it moves from either or to something and.
Yes. Okay.
Excellent. Okay.
Now, this is critical because this is where we get into difficulty. There's nothing wrong with dichotomous logic. But now take the paper that I sent you, which is dichotomous logic, and it is the misuse of dichotomous logic.
Mm-hmm. This document here?
That's it. That's it. Mm-hmm. The misuse of dichotomous logic forms what?
Isms.
And isms give what?
Privilege.
Now, I take things right out of the dictionary. So go to this last sentence in terms of privilege out of the dictionary. It says, such a right or advantage held as a prerogative of status or rank and exercised to the...
Where are you on here, Doc?
The last paragraph, the last sentence in that first paragraph.
Oh, such a right or advantage held by a prerogative of status... exercise to the exclusion or detriment of others.
Okay. So when you talk about white male privilege, it is to the what?
The detriment of others.
Exclusion and or detriment, mm-hmm. even mm-hmm. of
mm-hmm.
others.
Mm-hmm.
So you see, we shouldn't use the words loosely. We should look at them in terms mm-hmm. of what does it mean? So if you're talking about privilege, it is a prerogative that he has. It belongs to him. It is his right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it's his right even to the fact that I'm completely excluded from it, or it might even be to my detriment. It doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Because it is his prerogative, his right.
Mm-hmm.
It's essential to understand terms. If you don't, then you fly off the handle and you don't make sense.
Well, I like this because it's science and it removes the emotion.
Yes, it does. This is why you study philosophy. Or at least that's why they told me that I did. okay.
Only for 50 years that you've been doing this. That's all.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now let's construct what is necessary to form an ism. Misusing dichotomous logic. All right, the three steps to form an ism. Use your cultural bias to determine which characteristics are good and which characteristics are bad. So an example of that is...
Define cultural bias for people.
Cultural bias is concepts, principles, and ideas of society that have been reinforced to become the status quo.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so if you've had concepts, principles, and ideas that have been reinforced since you were a little child,
or socialization.
Yes, gives you that cultural bias.
Okay.
In our literature, in American literature, cultural bias is there, because if you read books, mm-hmm. then you will see when they talk about white people, they are beautiful and loving and caring, and when you read anything about blacks, you know what I tell people: if the only thing you saw was American films, and it showed black people in these films What would they do? They would be prostitutes. They would be drug addicts, drug dealers, murderers, shooters, rapists. If you were on a plane coming from Mars and the first person you saw when you got off the flagship or the landing from Mars, and you saw this big black man standing there, you'd get back on that flagship and fly back to Mars. You'd be scared to death.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
So, you know, we have to understand what these cultural biases, how they start very early, mm-hmm. and constantly reinforced and socialized.
Mm-hmm. Hmm? At birth or pre-birth, actually.
Yes. Yes. Now, you have there on your paper, assertive and submissive in two columns.
Mm-hmm.
All right. The first thing to form an ism is to use...
Hold on, Doc. I didn't mean to interrupt you, but did you want to state number two, state who is good and bad, number two, and to socialize everyone to believe the ism to be truth and to act upon that truth, the three steps to the ism?
Those are the three steps.
Okay.
So let's start with the first one. I'm saying that that first column that you have,
mm-hmm.
the top word is assertive,
mm-hmm.
and across from that is submissive.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm going to write on the top of the assertive column, and you can write it there, write good. And on the top of the submissive column, write bad. Now go back to that number one. To be assertive is to be good. To be submissive is bad. This is my Western cultural what?
Bias.
Yes. However, in some world cultures, to be submissive is to be what?
Good.
Yes. You see what I
mean? Assertive would be bad.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the next thing that I have to do, state who is good and who is bad. So to state who is good and who is bad then forms the what?
The ism.
And gives what?
Privilege.
All right, so let's do that. On the column that says good, write male. And the column that says bad, write female. Now what ism have I formed?
Gender bias.
Yeah, sexism.
Sexism.
All right, I'm saying that men are assertive, aggressive, powerful, strong, fearless, intelligent, and independent. And through the lower forms of nature, we find that women are submissive, passive, powerless, weak, fearful, ignorant, and dependent.
Wow. You just define all religions, mostly. This is incredible work. This is great. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay.
And coming from that European perspective, this makes complete sense when you look at it. Take the emotion out of it, family. Yes. That just look at the literature, look at the cultural bias, and you'll see it right there.
Yeah. Look at the difference in pay.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Just did a piece on that. Yes. Yes.
All right. Let's go on now.
Okay.
The next thing is I must socialize. Socialization of imprints, imprints the ism, mm-hmm. and conveys the status of truth. Now that's what I have to do. I have to socialize each one to believe the ism to be truth and to act on that truth, which is now what we call fake news.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Do you see what's going on?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I love the term socialization imprints the ism. So we have to imprint this with constant propaganda and media.
Yeah.
Okay. I forgot the name of the bias, but yes, go ahead.
All right. Now, how are we going to do this? Well, we start with little girls in the first grade.
Mm.
The teacher says 2 + 2, all the little girls wave their hand. But the teacher herself, a woman, is socialized not to promote this gender where girls are better, smarter, and what have you than little boys. So she doesn't call on the little girls. She calls on the little boys, and one of them says 2 + 2 = 3. And instead of her saying that's wrong, because it would crush him psychologically for the rest of his life, is what we say, okay? until someone says 2 + 2 = 4, and she says, well, what 2 + 2 + 2 = 3, she says, instead of saying it's wrong, she says, oh, it's an interesting answer. Who has a different answer?
Hmm.
Who has the right answer? You see what I'm saying? Because in dichotomy, if your answer is not right, it's what?
Wrong.
And the reason it's wrong is that you're not smart, you're what?
Dumb.
Does that, you see how dichotomous logic works?
Wow, loving this, Doc. Loving this, okay.
When it's misused.
When it's misused.
Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, so I'm imprinting into the little girl a socialization that she has to sit back and let boys be number one.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
Now go over to the side where it says female.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing that you tell little girls is, don't go into that dark room. Something will what to you?
Harm you, hurt you.
Yes, yeah. So that's to make you fearful.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, now let's see what else happens. Oh, don't try to do that. You are not strong enough.
Strong enough. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So get whom to help you.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Amazing. Mm-hmm.
Do you see how I'm imprinting a socialized truth that has nothing to do with reality? Now we're at the ninth grade.
And you just also, what you just said is the truth, that truth and reality are two different things.
Yes, yes. Now, what's very interesting is in the ninth grade, oh, don't take algebra. Algebra is too
hard
for girls to learn.
Right.
Which means you're too dumb to learn it.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we suggest that you take French.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody tells you about how many damn irregular verbs there are in French that you have to memorize, but that's okay. Okay. Now, are you seeing how that works?
This is amazing, absolutely.
All right, now let's move on further. You are now an adult woman. You have invested $200,000 of your family, your friends, everybody you owe, it's money, into a company. And your company sells products in semi-rural and rural areas.
Okay.
And they have these large carrying cases that, you know, demonstration of the product and so forth. Sometimes you have to go out and stay and sleep in the car because there's no motel or hotel around. If you get to a motel, it might be an X something, you know, that you'd see out of a horror movie or something.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Your $200,000 as a woman is invested in this firm. Now, based on the socialization that you've had in this sexist society where males are given privilege, whom are you going to hire to entrust your investment to go out into these communities and make sales?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It has to be a what?
A male.
Even though you are yourself a what?
A female who invested $200,000 into this company.
That's right.
Okay.
So you see now how women could perpetuate very often their gender bias to perpetuate into the society that women really can't do certain things.
It's the same thing that what Carter G. Woodson talked about, the backdoor theory.
Yes. Now let's go further, because what happens is you say to me, Dr. Nichols, why is this happening? And my response to you, my child, is that it is God's will.
Oh boy. Oh boy, there it is.
Well, now you see what happened when God entrusted to Eve that she completely did a complete reversal, and she destroyed males by her inquisitiveness.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Her flaw, her failure, her, okay, you see?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And she had to be punished.
Mm-hmm.
And every time she has a baby, she's going to be punished.
Mm.
So now you instill in women a natural process. It's frightening. Women are terrified.
Mm-hmm.
Okay?
And what you're also saying, too, this is from the European perspective. The African perspective is completely opposite. because Africans didn't have religion.
Yeah, well, they had their own. Well, let me give you one example with the Adam and Eve thing. You know, God comes and says, "Who ate the apple?" Okay, and Adam says, "The woman whom you gave me the apple to eat." So whom is he blaming?
Say again.
All right, Adam. God comes to Adam and says, "Who ate the apple?" And he says, "The woman you gave me, God, gave me the apple to eat."
Mm.
Whom is he blaming?
God.
No.
Blaming the woman.
Yes, he's blaming Eve.
He's blaming Eve. Okay.
Now, when you get the same story in West Africa, in East Africa, okay, they say the man says, "We ate the apple."
Mm-hmm.
Because it's the highest values in the relationship.
The relationship, I was going to say, there it is.
We ate the apple.
Wow.
That's the one that you gave me. She gave it to me to eat.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
See, when you look into the myths and the sayings and those kinds of things in the African traditions, they come from different parts of Africa, true, but they give you the same highest value lying in the relationship. And admonishment if you don't.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Now, I know the Native Americans is communal. They're not necessarily relational, they're more communal. What would their version be of that?
Well, with them, the highest value lies in oneness with the Great Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
So you don't have the gender bias situation.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because the Spirit can come in any forms to anyone. Mm-hmm. You have women who are the crow, as well as men who are the crow in their metaphysical reality.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And the Asians?
Well, in Asian culture, the highest value is in the cohesiveness of the group. So they don't have Christianity as a myth.
Mm-hmm.
Or Judaism. They don't have those myths. If you look at India, the biggest figure is a female figure.
Mm-hmm. Fascinating. Okay.
All right. Now let's go a little further. What you have a situation where I told you that it was God's will.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're not buying that, you start to give me some problems. And using dichotomous logic, it's very clear that you're not acting sanely.
Mm-hmm.
You're not acting ladylike.
Mm-hmm.
You are becoming a pushy, hostile B word.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I've now labeled you. The function of labeling is to put you back in your place or warn others that you're a danger.
Mm-hmm.
Nigger, I told you don't come in here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You better look out for that nigger.
Mm-hmm.
You see the process of labeling.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
To put the person back in their place or to warn others that they're dangerous.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, to complete this, it's not enough to just say that you're a troublemaker as a woman. I must now make it scientific. Something that can be counted and measured.
Mm-hmm.
It's become theory.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it's very clear that a few women act in this way.
Mm-hmm.
It is because Professor Dr. Sigmund Freud himself has told us
mm-hmm.
that women who act in this way are suffering from penis envy.
Mm-hmm.
It's mm-hmm. a neurosis that must be treated with psychoanalytic therapy. So now, not only is she a bitch,
mm-hmm.
but she's a crazy bitch.
Break it down for us, Dr. Nichols. Break it down. Oh my gosh. Okay. This is great.
Now, if she has mental problems, then you can understand, well, oh, don't pay any attention to her. She's just troublemaker. She's a crazy bitch. She'll pay her. Which is to neutralize it. So it no longer has any positive effect. See, you're nullifying it. You're neutralizing it.
And we can see that easily applied from this European model or axiology in terms of Black people.
That's right. Of course.
Absolutely.
See, the effect of women pushing for their rights has been repackaged, and the message is to neutralize it.
So as you said earlier when we were talking, if I say Black Lives Matter, from their axiology, they're going to neutralize this. They have to say what? All lives matter.
Yes. I'll go through the process with you.
Okay.
Now, now that you've seen how that works with sexism, go back to the top of your column that says assertive. And now write white. And on the other side, write black.
Okay.
So now what ism do you have now?
Oh boy.
There it is. Racism.
As I say, there it is in black and white.
Yes.
Okay. Let's put my line down the middle here, pal family. Yes,
let me go down now and give you the reality. The reality is that white males are good. Because they are assertive, aggressive, powerful, strong, fearless, intelligent, and independent. They aspire to wealth because they're industrious, thrifty, and prompt. They live in clean, beautiful, valuable suburban housing, which is paid for with oil depletion allowances, farm subsidies, and tax shelters. Their wives dutifully bring them cocktails in the evening or a can of beer, contingent upon their socioeconomic class. They espouse publicly virtue, chastity, and legitimacy for passing on their wealth, the object, to their children.
Wow.
Now let's go down the other side.
Oh boy. Get ready, fam.
All right. Black women are submissive, passive, powerless, weak, fearful, ignorant, and dependent. Black women live in poverty because they're lazy, they're wasteful, they're never on time, they have a lot of dirty, ugly children, which are worthless to our society. And they have this, you have to skip down, because they're hedonistic, promiscuous, and these illegitimate children, which are worthless to society, drain our resources in welfare, they cheat on food stamps, and they have extra babies just to get more ADC. Okay? Now, that aid to families of dependent children, that going right down that I just gave you,
which is in line opposite of the in this chart here. This,
yes,
it's direct opposite of this. Is fantastic. Okay, great.
Now, when you read that, then you go to our first Black president, Clinton, and what significant law did he pass to correct this whole form of degenerative behavior by Black women? The Welfare Reform Act. Get all your Black women up off your behind, get out and go to work. Well, why would they come up with that? I mean, where did that come from? We know there are more white people on welfare and aid to families of dependent children than Blacks.
Sure, absolutely.
So where did it come from?
Just by the numbers.
It came from this way of thinking and reasoning, which is the misuse of dichotomous logic to victims and give privilege.
Wow.
Why do they have segregated housing? Because you give white males privilege. Because they're good, they'll take care of their property, they'll, you see all those things? Mm-hmm. Well, you just go into the black community and you can see that they don't take care of their property. Well, what is the reality? It was old and dilapidated when they got it, when the white people moved out. The people who own it won't fix it. The garbage is picked up twice a week in the white community when there's one family per house. When you've got five and six people living in the rooms for one person, only garbage picked up once a week.
Mm-hmm.
Are you seeing the inequities that come?
Absolutely. 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 Great framework. Amazing framework. This is amazing. Okay.
Now, I share that with you because it's essential that you understand how this thing works.
Mm-hmm.
It is their logic system, and when they misuse it, it forms isms. Isms give privilege, and privilege is to the exclusion or detriment of others, and we are the others,
mm-hmm.
as African Americans.
Mm-hmm.
We're the others.
Speak to us about this, Doc, because we want to talk about one of the isms, colorism, and how we take on sometimes the personification, well, how we're socialized, like you talked about earlier, how a school teacher, female school teacher is socialized to not let the young girl answer the question. How are we socialized to create colorism because we're taking on the ideology of the European?
Well, I want to tell you that I'm so glad that her brother looks like he does and she doesn't. Because he has that bad nappy hair. And he's dark like his ugly old daddy.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now she's a little brown, but she got good hair.
Right. Right.
Okay.
Steven from Django Unchained, right?
Okay.
Absolutely.
So what we tend to do is, if you look at some of the movies produced by blacks historically, earlier ones, who gets the lead part? Who gets the dancing? Then you have that you have that institutionalized by the white society, which gives privilege to being light skinned with straight hair.
Mm-hmm.
So what? Who dances in the cotton club?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Brother, I'm sorry to tell you, you'd never make it.
I wouldn't make it in there, Doc. I wouldn't make it in there. I would have to wave at you as you were walking in, though. I'm telling you.
Me either.
No. I don't. Just a little less sun. I don't know. You might be able to make it in there, Doc.
No.
But, you know, this is what we need to have these conversations without emotion, because it's necessary for us to put it in framework and context so we can take it out.
You get Alina Horn, who is there, and you can't tell me when you go to see the Alvin Ailey dancers with all those beautiful black women dancing that she could dance or sing any better than any of them.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But the society, the people who ran the Cotton Club, the white people, did not want anybody other than whom they defined as being good to have those parts.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Now, she didn't have that internalized within herself,
because
her children she had by a black man.
Mm-hmm.
When she wasn't going to have babies for anybody and she needed the economic support and access, she married a white guy.
Mm. Mm.
Okay. That was not her issue. She wasn't color prejudiced or color conscious in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
Or she wouldn't have married the man she didn't have the children that she had.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
Now, if you look at where privilege is given for that kind of behavior, you'll have some of the, not today as much as before, but in New Orleans, you had a whole group of people who didn't identify with African Americans at all. They called themselves the Creole Band.
Mm-hmm.
They're all playing jazz, all living in the same community. But they separated themselves because one had privilege.
Mm-hmm.
Now, color prejudice goes around the world. When you go to Arab countries, go on your your what do you call it, Cirrus, mm-hmm. and you ask her what country has the largest importation of skin lighteners, like Natanola, skin whiteners. They're the Arab countries. Okay. Now, where does that come from? Well, that comes out of Europeans saying that whiteness is good and pure and what have you, and anything that's not that is something wrong. It's a deficit. Okay.
There, what you say, there it is. The socialization imprints the ism.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. 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 Excellent. Excellent. So we could also look at that in terms of brown paper bag, right?
Exactly.
With you know, college admission or church.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Same thing.
Yeah. Some churches. With the usher board, they have the darker women in the back, and around the perimeter of the altar where the pastor is, they have the fair-skinned women with the straightest hair. Why? Because we don't want the pastor to be distracted by some dark woman standing there.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the actual truth. I won't tell you where that happened, but I know it to be true.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And the woman who did that was a gatekeeper, which means she was a dark-skinned woman.
Mm.
Completely
proselytized and socialized. Wow.
Self-destruction.
Yes, yes, yes. Wow. Okay.
I'll give you
one. Well, now, then I do need you to speak on this then, Doc, because we are talking about this in terms of Stefan Clark. So we did a few shows on Stefan Clark in terms of police brutality. But one of the shows that we did was the self-destructive mentality he had, where he didn't like black women. He married or had children with, I think she was Asian. And would you speak to that? Because people are saying, well, we shouldn't give a damn about Stefan Clark being killed by the police because he didn't like us or didn't like black women. And so I see this treadmill of self-destruction behavior, because from my perspective, maybe it's just age, that they didn't ask him if he was pro-black or pro-white. They just saw him as the other.
Well, he talked black, but he sleeps white.
I love you. Okay. All right, Doc. Okay. All right. All right. Come on. I know.
That's how people talk. But now let's examine that and see what goes on.
Sure.
I was on a talk show where you come in and put the radio talk show and you put the earphones on.
Mm-hmm.
And this large basketball player, prominent, what have you, was talking about black women was dumb and black women were this, and he had a white woman, and he was going on and on and on. And I said, well, tell me, who's your mama? And he damn near came across the table to get me.
Oh, that just took it home right there. Talk about breaking it down.
All right. You see, wow. The important thing for us to understand is love is something that you can't control.
Mm-hmm.
It's a dependent variable. You love whom you have contact with. But
mm-hmm.
here's the other part of that, though, is if the society around you keeps telling you that black women can't be trusted, black women are the evil black woman, they're mm-hmm. aggressive, they're hostile.
Angry black woman syndrome.
Angry, the whole thing. That's what you're constantly hearing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Then why would you make a choice in that group?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Why would you do that when you have somebody that will... Now, let's just compare. The life that a white woman has with her white husband is far, far, far more submissive and destructive than if she's lucky enough to marry a black guy who sees her completely different, even if he treats her as he does a black woman.
Mm-hmm. Very well said. Thank you. Thank you for that.
You see, it's much better than what she would get dealing with this white man.
Well, you just said the white man is looking at his white wife, submissive, passive, powerless, weak, fearful, ignorant, and dependent.
That's right. And you see,
we just see an angry black woman. That's nothing compared to this.
That's right. Right?
Let's just keep it real. Okay.
Now, the reality is the way we survived slavery was that our women were strong and could carry on in our absence when we were sold from one plantation to another, never seeing our wife or children again. But she was able to keep them together as long as she could and to maintain the household as well as she could. See, we have to remember that we have a history of slavery, chattel slavery. We must never forget. You see how the adjective is a very important adjective.
Yes, it is. Slavery is different than chattel slavery.
Yes, sir. And so here is a man who wants his family from his African tradition and everything. They have a family. Okay? But in the United States, with chattel slavery, you were sold. The men could be sold from one place to another. Women could be sold. You have a 7-year-old child that can be sold away from its mother. Now, when you compare other forms of slavery, Louis XIV gives the Code Noir and says that families can't be broken up until at least the child is 8 or 9. In other words, you can't take children away from their parents if they're a family unit. Now, of course, they must be baptized Catholic. They must be raised Catholic. They must be able to keep, not work on Catholic holidays and so forth and all of that. That's a part of the Code Noir. But when you read inside, there are protections that you have that you don't have in our slavery system here. The other is actually you can take your slave master to court if he's too brutal. That's a part of Code Noir. That's the French slavery experience. It has nothing to do with ours.
No.
You see, ours is a constant taking away through legal processes the rights of the individual that moves him from an indentured servant, now free, to slave for life. If you want to see that progression, you go online and you type in Virginia slave laws. It'll all come up in sequence and you can see how it moves from there. Again, you have black women being charged a tax on their work that they had to pay. White women are indentured servants and make, they're now both free and they make this much money. Then there's a black tax. You got that book?
It's on the way. I downloaded the ebook, but I ordered the book, The Black Tax.
Yeah,
it was great because I saw I don't know if you saw the Google talk that we're talking about, Sean Rochester.
Yes.
Absolutely amazing. I had Mirza Baradaran on my show. And also, you know, I've had Dr. Jacqueline Battalora, who broke down how and when Europeans became white and why they created white people with privilege for those laws.
That's right.
And everything that you are giving us, even it just puts it into context with this framework. From the historical aspect, the axiological aspect of when they arrived on the planet, but also it gives a framework in reference to America and the uniqueness of America and slavery and chattel slavery and the invention of white people and why white people were invented and given certain privileges. This is absolutely amazing.
Yes. You see, the issue when you think of the object as the highest value, if you are a slave master, and you import people, and they are indentured servants, at the end of 7 years, they are free. Now, you have to think at that time, and this culture was primarily a British culture, One of the biggest issues in Britain even today is classism.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So women that were indentured servants, being white was not the issue. It was that they were not of the class that you would marry.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay? And of course, the blacks that were were indentured and got their freedom were also a lower class.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if those two classes married, like Benjamin Banneker's parents did,
mm-hmm.
it didn't really matter because they were both lower class.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And class was more important
mm-hmm.
than anything else. Now, the issue is you are beginning to see that all of these indentured servants are going out, getting their own land,
mm-hmm.
now become competition, which means they could take away from you axiologically your object.
Absolutely. There it is. There it is. Absolutely. Fantastic.
So now what do you have to do? What logic system will help you to decide what to do? Well, a dichotomous logic system that you misuse.
Mm-hmm.
So you say that white is good.
Mm-hmm.
And black is bad.
Mm-hmm. And you create anti-miscegenation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
And you now have a structure in which you can give privilege to whiteness,
mm-hmm.
charge extra, and ultimately slave for life, blackness.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because in those Virginia laws, if any of your mothers are black, then you are black and slave forever.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Wow. We'll have to have somebody come on and talk about the deeper psychopathic sickness that this is. I mean, I so greatly missed our elder and the Setmati, Dr. Frances Cress Wilson, because mm-hmm. She really can get into the deepness as the psychological aspects of this is absolutely amazing. When we look at our 45th, he really, really personifies this dichotomous logic. And when you, if you polarize the 45th with Barack Obama, you can really see all of this just completely mapped out, plain as day, no emotion whatsoever. What we're dealing with here. Now, as African-Americans, as black people, relational people, in one of my, I forgot what show it was on that you were on, but you said you have to go to work white and come home black. So it's just, you know, you're talking about the dealing with.
Yes, I work white and I live black when I'm home with my
yes, family. Yes, yes.
Which means that when I'm at work, I know that I am an object.
Mm-hmm.
And people do things, it's nothing personal. It's just for them to have more acquisition of the object.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I represent a non-entity to them.
Mm-hmm.
I have to compete with them as objects. Mm-hmm. So anything that I do, it's nothing personal.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How many times have people said as a white supervisor to a black person, they just lower their rating to satisfactory and then say, well, let's go and have lunch. Because it's nothing personal. And
mm-hmm. you know,
the highest values in the relationship, that's the last person on earth you'd want to have lunch with.
Right. Right. Absolutely.
Okay.
Can you speak to the nuance of that? And let me put it in context. So we have a growing number of intercultural relationships and children. That I have been contacted by on several occasions in terms of they're going through a massive identity crisis. You know, America by 2045, 2050, America turns brown, because I've been doing all this research on birth dearth and demography and the Europeans basically becoming almost extinct and dying off in record numbers. And so still in place, however, is this dichotomous logic, is this socialization that's imprinted on us. And so parts of our family have been integrated into a European family. And they don't know what to do and where to go, some of them. What advice would you give them based upon this? Because, you know, you and I can probably relate to this much better because we have, you know, we come from African parents. But if you have different parents and your one parent is European, the other one is Black, or one is Indian, the other is European, where does all of this fit? How do you identify dealing with colorism and the isms?
Okay. Some 30 years ago, I was asked the same issue in Seattle. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
In Seattle, that's one of the first places in the United States that you had an appreciable number of interracial marriages between Black men and white women.
Mm-hmm.
What would happen when they divorced if the white woman moved into the Black community with her mixed race child? The child developed and socialized as Black,
mm-hmm.
made better psychological adjustments, better academic adjustments, and so on. If she took her mixed race child to her white family in the white neighborhood, when they first arrived, they were exotic because of their hair and things like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But when little girls get to be 10, they become very, very hostile toward other little girls. They have little cliques. So that's when you would see that the little mixed race girl was not be invited to birthday parties.
Mm. Interesting.
Little boys are accepted more for a longer period of time because they're athletic and they play ball. But now he's 16 and he represents a threat to the whiteness of my daughter.
Mm.
Now, they have been socialized in a white environment. That's their socialization. But because of their physical appearance, they return to the Black community hoping to be accepted there. But bringing their white socialization, they have no mechanisms or tools by which they can interact in that environment.
Mm-hmm.
So very often they're not accepted there, or they're exploited.
Mm-hmm.
Have sex with me if you think you ain't better than me.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So you get sexual exploitation, you get a lot of other things, trying to be assimilated into this environment in which you have no coping skills.
Mm. Wow.
Those were my experiences some 30 years ago in the Seattle area.
Wow.
Now, of course, you have more children who are mixed race.
Mm-hmm.
One of the places that you want to see the highest degree of inter really race mixing is when you go to Trinidad, Tobago.
Mm.
When you get to Trinidad, because they had indentured servants that came from after the slavery was over, Blacks weren't going to work on plantations anymore. They had these huge plantations and they needed workers, so they imported Chinese and Indians. All right, when the Indians came and the Chinese, they were at the lowest round on the ladder because the Blacks moved into the city, like in Guyana, and they took the positions of city clerk, police, fire department, and so on. And the Indians stayed in the country on the land.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, when you go to Trinidad, these people have been together for so long that interracial marriage is, I personally know one fellow who, he married a woman whose father was Chinese, the mother was Indian. This is as pure as you can get.
Mm.
That's his wife. He has a father who is Chinese and a mother who is Black.
Mm.
Now, when they have children, what are those children?
I have no idea. that is a mixture of a, that's amazing. I don't know. That's, you know, I don't want to be ignorant to say a mutt, but I mean, you know, when we talk about all these races mixing together, I mean, you know, there is no, and let's first of all define too, we already know race is not even something that exists. It's a construct of classification. So Rich is talking about ethnicities and culture. So I don't, I would not even know the answer to that. I just call them, and you know,
so when,
I would just call them family.
Yeah, when people come up and ask me of the philosophical aspects of cultural difference, which group do I belong to? And of course, what it is, then it becomes more of a socialized reality. How then are you socialized?
Okay.
You see that in those islands, the Chinese run businesses, and they keep their money together. And they intermarry among themselves. Once in a while, it gets out differently. But for the most part, that's where the value is, in keeping their group cohesive. Indians who have the same reality, the same axiology, you have two groups of Indians. You have the Indians that were Muslim coming from India and those that were Hindu. Those that are Hindu don't intermarry to the same degree as those who are Muslim. Muslim Indians kind of disappear. So you have this very tall, dark man with straight hair from a big, strong black woman and a big an Indian, which gives you this 6'2" big black guy with straight hair. And when you hear him speaking, he, you know, well, let me give you Howard University right here in Washington, D.C. Many of the people that were from Guyana or Trinidad or those places came to Howard University to go to school. Now, when you look at them, they look Indian or they look Chinese. But they don't interact with the Indians and Chinese here because they're not considered one to be pure. And they have nothing in common with them. So you see them at all of the steel drum parties and everything else because they have been totally socialized into West Indian thinking.
So we need to look at how are you socialized. That's going to be the defining characteristic.
Yes.
Fantastic. Okay. Well, let's talk about this then in terms of how does this, now that we have the framework of dichotomous logic and the philosophical aspects of cultural difference, how does that translate? You do work with police officers, police stations, and law enforcement. Walk us through some of your experience in that.
Well, there are two types of programs that I put on. One is if your city has a police academy, then what I will do is I will ask for a module, which is a 1-day or 2-day in-service training. And that is primarily to help people understand those philosophical differences. Then we look at the work that was done by Harvard University in terms of how people perceive others or perceive Black men based on the total years of socialization. But we also look to see how police themselves are socialized. What are police told to do? They're told if you pull your gun, it's to shoot, and you don't shoot to wound or to disable, you shoot to kill. Now, when you have a person coming into a dark situation or into any kind of a situation, and they are already petrified, that this could be their life based on all of the things that they bring from their socialization as white men into this barbaric, hostile, frightening situation with this black male, then you have the potential for explosion and for things that we later decode as insensitivity of police, police brutality. And so that's like one module.
Speak to that a little deeper, if you could, because the other aspect of that is that, you know, Philando Castile, I think the police officer was Asian in terms of the Stephon Clark. One police officer was white, the other one was black. And so there's a socialization within the socialization, if you will.
Yes. So what you have is, if you have a black police officer, he has the same trepidation, because if you look at that Harvard measuring scale that measures your attitude, you'll find that black people are just as afraid of other black people as white people are. Mm-hmm. So he's going into that same situation, and he has the same training in terms of shoot, shoot to kill. Mm-hmm. And so he brings that with him. It's compounded by someone saying, gun! And then all the fear that both of them have is not just to shoot once, to lame, to stop, to enable, not enable, but
disable
the person. No, you get 20 shots.
So there's the framework again. It's look at the socialization. It's not at that point, it's not about a black or white issue. It's a socialization issue.
Socialization as a police officer. What is this?
Excellent.
Now,
what's the other module?
The other training that I give is a 2-day workshop where I take, you've had a real hostile situation going on. So you take a group of police officers and a group of the people who are in the community, not just the old people like I am who are leaders, but the young people out there yelling and screaming. Okay? You bring the two groups together and you force them to sit down and you do what is called focus groups. You then write as a scribe, what are they saying in those groups? And what you come up with is a lot of information about how they feel toward each other and what they see as the other. Now, what I technically do then is I take that focus group information and put it into a questionnaire. And the questionnaire is then administered across members of the community, members of the police force. And then there's an analysis of variance or different forms of statistical analysis of what those questionnaires said. Then you begin to get a valid picture of how the two groups see each other and see themselves. Then from that information, you can begin then to work toward a way to neutralize, to create a situation in which police come together with community and work. You can't ask me as a police officer to go down and work in the black community when I have no knowledge of how I'll be received. Nor can you ask me to accept this white police officer that comes in when he's already stopped me with stop and frisk twice. See, stop and frisk is one of the most detrimental things that we have. Because when you stop me and frisk me, no one can help me. I have to ask, are you going to kill me? Will I survive this?
It's called STEM, isn't it? Stop, space, time, energy, and movement.
Okay.
That's it. When they pull you over and stop and frisk you, that's it. You are held hostage.
Yes. Now, can your parents help you? Can your community help you? No, because if they come up, they can be in trouble too, because they're not doing what they're supposed to do, and they can be arrested or grabbed and thrown against the wall.
Sure.
Now, when you frisk me, think in terms of the physical posture that I'm in. I have my hands on the car. I'm bent over. My legs are spread far apart. Everyone in my community is watching. And then this man does what to me?
He frisks me, feels me from top to bottom.
Yes. Now, what image is that?
That's going back to chattel slavery. I mean, it's
devastating. Rape.
Yeah.
It's rape.
Wow.
and you can do nothing about it. Now, we know from statistics that Black men in Black communities are stopped and frisked more times than they are in the Black population of that community. So now you've had these things happen to you three times, and now Nichols is coming to you saying, well, we all have to get together and work. But if you as the white officer don't know how much hostility and anger I have because of that experience, or as the white officer, I don't know how many times I've come into a Black situation and people spit at me or yell at me or throw something out the window at me. I ask, what's going on in the community? Nothing. Nobody knows anything. So that's why you do the focus groups. That's why you do the questionnaire, because each community has those things that are most concern to that police community interaction.
Allow me to be devil's advocate. I don't think the family would allow me to get off the hook if I don't ask this question, and that is, when you look at policing, law enforcement, which is a part of the institutionalized white racism, when you look at that level of socialization, that I think you only have to have a high school diploma to become a police officer. And sometimes you don't have to have that. You just have to know someone and get on the force. Coming from a Europeanized socialization of how they see people of color, Black people, using dichotomous logic, is it feasible to entertain that a white tenured police officer would even be open to something like this, let alone become, if you will, unthawed and more understanding within their dichotomous logic?
Well, let's look to see what has been the reality for police in the African community. The police are the enforcers of the law. So in slavery, what was the law? The law was to keep you enslaved. So if you try to run away, who comes to get you? If you hit a white person, who makes sure that you don't do that ever again in life? And other people recognize that you will never do that in life. All right. Now, if you look at police departments today, they look as though they're going to go into combat. Motorized vehicles, shields, gloves. It's a combative situation. So police don't see themselves like an English police officer with no gun walking the beat, who is there to protect and serve, but he's there to enforce the law. Now, do you have a permit to march? No. Do you have the right of assembly? Yes. Semicolon, however, comma, stay behind this line, stay in this space, what have you. I'm exercising my right. Get off this corner. I'm not involved in the group. I'm just here. I'm getting ready to go to my, get off of this corner. So the role of the police in the Black community has always been seen as the enforcer of unjust laws. And so now it has gone to the degree that it's like an army attacking a population of soldiers, radical something. Do you see the threat that the Black Panthers represented?
Yeah, absolutely.
So if you have in California open carry of guns, then if they're going to carry guns, You see, in dichotomous logic, we can carry guns, but you cannot. Okay. Now, if you are carrying guns, then I have to do something that prevents you from carrying guns. So within less than a week, the legislature in California changed the law. Now, if you carry guns or you have guns, you are acting against the law. And the people who will protect the law against you, the lawbreaker, are the police.
All right. So then, last question, Doc, is we talked about the socialization of going to work white, coming home black, as it relates to law enforcement. What is our assignment? What is our mindset? What is our socialization? What should we do and how should we approach it to either break it or circumvent it?
Well, we as a community have already done what is necessary to circumvent a degree of it. When we talk and say, I gave my son the talk. That's one of the tools that we have used for the survival of our children. We have given him the talk. Now, in terms of other things, the fact that you have video reporting of many of the things that go on, that's going to force police now to be more mindful of what happens when things are recorded. Therefore, most recently, if you remember, they muted the voice. Now, is that behavior going to be punished? Or will it be just overlooked? Now, in the dark, and it was dark, he screams, gun. How can you see a gun? It was the phone. That's what they found. We don't even know whether he had the phone in his hand or not. Because if I scream gun, then after that moment, everything that I do is justified. And when the lights turn on or the what have you, I can say, well, I thought there was a gun. And therefore, the court says, well, if you thought there was a gun, then your life was in jeopardy and you are exonerated. And the black community says, why would you shoot 20 times? Or why would you have 8 shots in the back? If this is someone you said was running towards you and you muted the camera and the voice. So you see, there's a lot of suspicion and no place or very few places do you get police where they're actually found guilty. Now, where you have a black police chief of police in one of these southern cities, he fired him a white boy and put another on probation. But how often will you see that happen? Because if you really enact laws and enforce the laws, then you're going to destroy the very force that is necessary for you as a society to survive when you send your troops forward to press, to put down this insurrection or this mob that are going to come in and destroy our community, or these people that are going to come in and rape our daughters.
Okay.
There has to be a price. And the police have to be demilitarized. A price for misbehavior. And then the demilitarization of police.
So one would argue and say that what you're saying is absolutely correct. Yes, but in order to do that, that would make the police, the laws, completely vulnerable to this other. And well, we can't have that.
Yeah, it makes them accountable.
Mm.
Accountability is what we want. We don't want privilege. We just want accountability.
Mm.
We want accountability.
If okay. you just walk that's up, that inch. That's that inch. That's different than privilege and saying we want equal. Yes. We want accountability. So that's an inch that we can work toward.
Yes. Accountability.
Yeah, I like that. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I feel like I just graduated and I need a degree of some sort. I need a piece of paper signed from you, Dr. Nichols. Thank you so much for this amazing conversation. And of course, you know, I'm going to beg you to come back again. it's not over. It's not over. This is just the beginning. All right, family, you know what to do. I need you to comment. I need you to like. I need you to share. I see the numbers of you that are watching live right now, and I absolutely am floored and honored by that and for this amazing, amazing, brilliant mind who is a 50-year veteran of philosophical aspects of cultural difference and dichotomous logic. It's a framework that works. I have not found or heard or seen anything like it. And I'm just honored and proud that Dr. Joy DeGruy gave me your phone number and said, call him. I said, okay, I'm calling it. And I did. And you have changed. I don't know if you've had a chance. You probably haven't because you've been too busy with your daughter flying around getting all kind of stuff. But the comments that of people that you have just changed their lives and put so much of what they have experienced into context to relieve themselves of the emotion that they have been feeling, to give an understanding and a framework for what they can do next. I can't thank you enough, Dr. Nichols. Would you stick around with me in the green room as we sign off?
Yes, I'll be glad to. Mm-hmm.
Thank you, my friend. Take care, everybody. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live.